Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is John Kelly, who's worked as a production assistant in film and television on shows as Law & Order, Fringe, and many more. Please welcome John Kelly.
Hi. Nice to see you, Rick. Yeah,
thanks for being here. Well, let's start with sort of the most basic question of all. What inspired you to get into film production?
Well, I've actually, I've been kind of artistically inclined ever since I could remember, from a very young age. And I remember when I went to NYU, when I was enrolled, I was undeclared at the time. And I remember I had a roommate and I had a couple of other friends who were actually in film production at the time. And I knew that their, film program had a really good reputation. And I saw what they were doing as being something that, was obviously very much appealing to me. And I thought, especially knowing people who had done it, it seemed very tangible to me. So then I just kind of went about the process of seeing what it took to, apply, to transfer into the film program. And, the rest is history. I already had a couple of videos in the can from work that I had done in high school. And, just had to prepare some essays and went through the process, had my fingers crossed all semester, and eventually, things worked out.
How far along in your academic career were you when you made the switch?
I only actually transferred out within the first year or so. So it was probably about halfway through. I think it was probably around finals my first year that I found out I had been accepted into the film program. And at that point, it became very difficult to focus on my finals because I was interested at all in, whatever geology or something that I was taking at the time. I was just ready to dig into the film work.
Well, so one of the terrific things about having you on our program today is that you are a young person in the film industry. You're making your way, not that long out of school, and we have a bunch of students here in the studio and watching on at home who are soon to be in your shoes. So can you tell us a little bit about those first steps after college and how you sort of start building that career?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I have to say, the most immediate work that I did coming out of school was not even, it wasn't a paying gig. It was actually, I volunteered at the Silver Docks Documentary Festival, which is local. It's in Silver Spring, Maryland. And, I wanted to do that very soon after I graduated. That was within a couple of months. I think it was like June or July of that year. And, I just wanted to keep myself relevant, stay involved in any way I could. And, I ended up, I went into it just wanting to volunteer generally, not really having any specific desire to do, any specific type of job. But they had a need on the technical end. They took a look at my music video, which I had done, in school in a study abroad program. They liked the camera work that I had done and some of my direction, and they decided to take me, take me on as a camera person. And I ended up actually walking around, the festival for the week or so that I was there, shooting a lot of B-roll of, all different angles of the event, and that ended up kind of being a springboard. I ended up doing that 2 years following, and it was actually as a result of that work that I did that I ended up getting, my job with Law & Order probably 2 or 3 years later.
So you converted essentially a volunteer position into a paying gig then?
Absolutely. Well, it's funny though, because it wasn't direct, but it ended up taking several years, but it was because of people that I met there, and I guess it was because of a positive impression that I made that I eventually ended up, getting paying more.
Before we move chronologically forward, you said something I just can't resist following up on, which is the idea of doing a study abroad program and making a music video. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, well, actually, NYU has a really great program. I think it was kind of still in its infancy when I went. This was probably back in about 2006, I want to say. But basically, they have a program set up there that's in cooperation with a music magazine in Ireland called Hot Press, which is basically, I guess, like the equivalent of Rolling Stone to Ireland. And basically what they do is before the spring when we arrive, they have a contest with all kinds of independent bands in the country. To kind of submit their music for this what they set up to be a contest. And basically whoever we then as the students go in and choose if we like the work, if we like the music, we basically pick out of a pile of CDs, decide that we like a particular artist, and then, go about the process of producing and directing a music video for
them. So. Do you have access to the artists at all?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Very direct access. Yeah. I had we would have regular meetings with the managers of the bands and the actual bands themselves and kind of be very creatively linked to them in the whole process.
What a great way to build up a portfolio, too.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And it's very, well, the thing is, too, it's great to say that you had your work with that kind of exposure, because actually, It ended up being broadcast through that magazine's website on the internet. You know, it was featured on their page and everything. And my video, as well as a couple of other videos, you know, of some of my colleagues, ended up actually being broadcast on national television there.
Great. So, what a great springboard.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially for, you know, to start in a smaller market. It's funny because, you know, coming from the States, it seems like, you know, it seems like a smaller, it's definitely a smaller market, but, you know, I guess that reduces a little bit of the anxiety about doing it. You know, you seem like you can have a lot more impact on a lot smaller ground.
So moving forward again now, did you have any significant internships as part of your career development, or did you leapfrog right into the driver's seat?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I did, I had, let's see, I'm trying to keep track now because there were so many. I probably had probably between 4 and 5 internships while I was still a student. And usually, you know, those rotated per semester. So I didn't really stay in any one place more than, you know, probably 3 to 4 months. But, you know, they varied in scale in terms of what companies I was working for. You know, I worked for kind of a smaller production house here in Arlington when I was home for the summer because I was born and raised in the area. Called Henninger Productions, and that's in Arlington, and they do, or at least they were doing at the time, a lot of work for some of Discovery's satellite networks. And beyond that, when I was in New York, I worked for another similar size production company there, as well as working for video promotion in Epic Records at as part of Sony.
So you really covered a lot of different bases. Was that intentional or just the way it worked out?
Yeah, you know, it kind of was just the way it worked out because my interest changed over time, you know, depending on what classes I was taking and depending on, you know, even, you know, what films I had seen at the time. And kind of, you know, my interests tended to wander a little bit. And at the time that I ended up at Epic, for example, you know, it was just on the heels of my music video program. So I was very interested in getting into music video production. Yeah. So, I mean, that gave me great exposure to that side of, you know, the industry because all of those are generated as a result of the artists. You know, if it wasn't for the artists and it wasn't for the labels' demand to get them promoted, then they, you know, videos wouldn't exist. So that was another angle to the same, you know, it was another piece of the same puzzle.
Let me take you back to Henninger for a minute, because Rob Henninger was a guest on our show a couple of seasons ago. We had a great time with him and learned a lot about his work in that big studio. Tell us what you did there and the whole Discovery connection.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, when I worked there, I was actually, I think part of what I was doing was researching productions that were eventually, you know, going to be, well, I guess they had already been marketed to Discovery Networks and, you know, they were kind of being prepped for production, you know, eventually to air on, I think at that time their primary connection was Discovery Military, which I'm not sure if they're active anymore. But anyway, so that involved a lot of hands-on research, a lot of very kind of involved, you know, a lot of it was on the internet, but there was also a lot of times that I would go off-site, especially to the National Archives.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah, they have a very big media center that's in, I think it's somewhere in Maryland. I think it's like College Park, Silver Spring, something like that. Anyway, and I actually ended up spending, you know, a few days scrubbing through, you know, old 35mm newsreels of, at that time, I think it was old World War One tank footage or something like that. And it was
fantastic.
Just, yeah, it was great.
Well, this just sort of, I mean, illustrates, I think, an interesting point about life in any business, which is that you never can predict what is going to be required of you, and you have to be ready for anything.
Absolutely.
Sounds like you've made that
Yeah, exactly. It's, you know, I see the way that, you know, you kind of make yourself continue to be relevant in the industry is to kind of, you know, prepare yourself in any way possible and to kind of, you know, keep your tool belt stocked with all kinds of different skills that you learn along the way and continue to bring that to bear.
So as you walk around with that stocked tool belt now, tell me, how did you get your first significant job then?
Well, let's see, my first significant job, I would say it was probably when I was office production assistant in Law and Order.
Oh yeah.
And it's funny because that relates to what I was saying before about my very, very first, you know, out of school gig, which was at Silver Docks, because it actually ended up being as a result of someone I met there who was, I guess, kind of the video coordinator at Silver Docks, who was also kind of very connected in production in DC. I guess the channels through which the job opportunity for Law & Order filtered were mainly through production people, and that was how she actually got wind of it. She knew that I was in New York and kind of working towards that kind of career, sent me the, you know, opportunity, and I was able to get an interview, and the rest is history.
That's a perfect networking story, isn't
it? Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, and the thing is, too, I think it's a perfect example of why, you know, you should never really cut yourself off to any potential opportunity, because you really never know where it's going to lead you.
And always hope that you leave a good impression behind when you're
Yeah, absolutely. Well, yeah, that being said, once you have the opportunity and you find yourself in that position, you know, kind of keep your composure and, you know, try and make a very good impression on everyone that you see.
We'll talk more about Law & Order in our next segment, but I'd like to turn to our students and see if
they
have any questions
now.
Mm-hmm. Any questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
Yes, what filmmakers inspire you?
You know, it's interesting that you asked me that. I probably would have to say it depends on what I've seen in the last 6 months. Because really, especially as a function of my education, I found that a lot of what helps kind of keep you stimulated and keep you fresh is the fact that you're not getting stale, that you're not getting fixated on anything in particular. You just kind of have to constantly be refreshing, you know, your creative stores, and you constantly have to be looking for new sources of inspiration. So that's a bit of a cop-out, but hopefully it's truthful enough.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. I'm actually curious. It sounds like you've done a lot of work and internships through school, but have you ever had a difficult time finding a job?
Absolutely. I mean, especially, you know, especially when I was trying to make a transition from being a set PA, which I was doing for probably about a year or so, trying to transition out of that and trying to get into more of an office environment where I would be kind of, you know, much more intimately engaged with the people who were making important decisions. It was very difficult because, you know, I spent a lot of time kind of, there was a period of a couple of months where I was just sending out a lot of resumes, just cold. And what I found, you know, was unfortunate about it is it's really a significant advantage to have someone, you know, kind of in your corner. And when you're going out like that, you know, on your own, it's very precarious because you really don't have anyone to you know, kind of usher you or vouch for you. And it's really, you know, significant, very important to you that you have other people who can vouch for you and who are, you know, sticking up for you.
Great. Another question.
Yes. Hi, I was wondering if you can tell us what the most rewarding part of your last job was?
Most rewarding part of my last job? it's going to sound kind of silly, but it's probably the hours. Because the last thing I was doing, I was an accounting clerk on a pilot for USA called A Legal Mind, which has actually been picked up, and it's going to be shot in Toronto now. But, you know, that's neither here nor there. You know, it doesn't seem very glamorous, but they actually end up getting the best hours of everybody. I mean, if you think as an office PA, you know, sometimes periodically I would work 14, 15 hour days. And now, you know, having like a 9 to 6 seems like a vacation. So, yeah, it was excellent. I think I paid a little bit better, too. But.
Another question, please. Yes, sir.
What advice would you give to college students who want to become filmmakers?
Well, I think it kind of, you know, it speaks to what I was saying before in terms of, you know, being aware of opportunities that are presented to you and just kind of taking advantage of them. I mean, definitely if you see yourself having an opportunity, especially in the immediate future, of, you know, doing anything that you see being even closely related, whether that be working on a film festival or, you know, even doing, you know, I've done on the side, sometimes I've done like viral video work. Anything that you think will keep you kind of relevant and connected, I think is definitely worth doing. And beyond that, I think, you know, definitely some people would say that, you know, it helps to move to New York or LA. I mean, you know, I don't know that that's as true today as it might have been maybe 30 years ago or something like that. But I think definitely, again, anything you can do to kind of, you know, inject yourself in the process and just stay relevant and stay, you know, around people who are, you know, influential and who, you know, are connected to other people. Because you're always connected to other people by degrees. So it's like if you meet one person, you're not necessarily just meeting one person. You're exposing yourself to maybe, you know, 15 or 20 other people potentially. So it's not worth, you know, cutting off any one person or any one opportunity.
Wise advice.
Yeah.
Another question. Yes, ma'am.
I was just wondering, what are some of the struggles and opportunities when filming on locations such as New York?
Well, I have firsthand experience with a lot of the struggles, because it's definitely, especially working as a set PA, you know, you're kind of on the front lines for the production. You are the first line of defense between, you know, all of the shooting crew and everybody else in New York City who's trying to do, you know, whatever they might be doing in their personal life at the time. So, you know, yeah, oh, I've been, you know, heckled and gotten the finger and, you know, had people kind of, accost me before. And that's always a struggle, but, you know, I think that's part of what makes it exciting, and I think that's part of what makes it authentic, too, is because, you know, in New York specifically, you know, you are actually in these settings that you are kind of, you know, purporting to be setting the show. And that, I think that gives it a certain layer of authenticity and realism that you might not get if you were trying to do everything on a stage or, you know, in some remote location that's not even related. And I think people who live in New York, too, can recognize the difference. Like, I think the CSI that's set in New York, I think they shoot almost none of that in New York. And, you know, people who know better, you know, can tell the difference.
So. Yeah, poor old Toronto, you know, standing in for so many places. Let's have one more question from the student body. Anybody else? Yes.
Do you plan on working in Los Angeles?
You know, it's funny. It's kind of one of those questions that's always, you know, in the back of your mind as someone who does film and television production. I've known, you know, plenty of people who started out in New York and then moved to L.A., do it for a couple of years and then move back. Or I've known people who've, you know, worked in L.A. for 15 or 20 years and then they moved to New York. So, you know, it's really, I think after a certain point, it just becomes kind of a lifestyle question. You know, some people like the atmosphere in L.A. better. Some people like the atmosphere in New York better. I've kind of taken to New York since I've been there, so I don't really see myself immediately moving, but that's not to say that it's outside the realm of possibility. So,
all depends on what the phone call is, right?
Exactly, yeah. It's like, you know, if Spielberg wants to call me up tomorrow and, you know, make me his personal assistant or something like that, you know, I'll consider it.
Ask him to come to New York. You know?
But anything outside of that, it's not really worth considering. So.
Well, I would love to talk a little bit more about Law & Order because it's such an iconic television show and it has ended its very long and distinguished run. And you were around for the last season, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's an interesting subject all by itself. But before we get into that, tell us a little bit about your role and your various jobs on that show.
Sure. I mean, you know, I guess when I worked on that, it's hard to define a specific role because, you know, they kind of used me to their advantage in almost any possible situation that they could. So, you know, okay, daily, you know, responsibilities included things like, you know, answering phones, making copies of relevant production paperwork, whether that be, you know, call sheets, scripts, you know, and then distributing all that paperwork to the various, you know, important heads of different departments. And then, you know, other more mundane things, I think, you know, helping different vendors get in and out of the freight elevator, carrying large, because one of our things then was that NBC was trying to go green, so we were trying to get rid of bottled water, which meant we had huge stores of these, you know, 3-gallon jugs that you typically put in water coolers. And, you know, we would have to cart like a dozen of those, you know, down to one of the Teamster vans so they could take it out to set. I mean, just, you know, all kinds of like, you know, insane what would seem like mundane tasks, but in the context, you know, it seems once you've done one of these things, you know, 20 or 30 times, it seems perfectly reasonable that someone asks you to, you know, go take somebody down to the freight or whatever.
Mm-hmm. So, right.
So yeah, and driving was very important. In fact, that actually ended up playing a role in why I ended up getting the job, because if it wasn't for the fact that I had a valid driver's license at the time, I might not have even been considered.
That's an unusual. Unusually important credential, actually.
Yeah,
absolutely. To bring to the table. Yeah.
Absolutely, because you never
so
know. You know,
learn to drive.
Yeah, because people don't always call on you for it. But people, that's the other thing I was saying about the tool belt. You know, people don't always call on all of your skills at all times. But there's usually going to be a time when somebody needs some skill, mm-hmm. and if you're the one who has that, you become an invaluable asset. So the more, you know, the more skills that you've acquired, the better capable you are of taking care of things like that.
What was the atmosphere on that set, on that show? Because legendary cast and, mm-hmm. you know, and such a nice, such a long run and such a real contribution to American television.
Yeah.
What was it like being around those folks?
It was great. I mean, I think everyone, especially who was there, was very much aware of, you know, the significance of the production that they were doing. And so everyone took their jobs very seriously. But also, you know, everyone had been kind of in the same atmosphere for so long that they kind of took on, you know, it kind of became more of a family than a crew because people, you know, were very kind of intimately tied together. And especially, you know, I think it's hard to work for so long for so many hours of your life with you know, a relatively small amount of people without feeling close to mm-hmm. them. You know, unless you're completely callous. But I didn't really meet a whole lot of people like that. Everybody, you know, seemed to be very warm and welcoming.
Any of the actors stand out as being particularly notable in your experience?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the ADAs, the assistant district attorneys mm-hmm. on the show, who were played by Alana De La Garza and Linus Roach, they were fabulous. They were probably some of the, you know, most down to earth and warmest actors I've ever mm-hmm. dealt with. You know, always referring to everybody on a first name basis and just very kind, very easy to get along with.
Did you ever have anything like directly involved in the daily process with the actors in terms of
Well, you know, yeah, okay, periodically. It's funny because you have to kind of be on call for mm-hmm. random errands that people need. And, you know, because you have a desk where, you know, where you're kind of camped out at all times, you know, I had a phone line and I had a computer with internet. So, you know, periodically, like Sam Waterston would want to come over and, you know, check his email or print something out or something like that. You know, that's just it's part
Sorry,
of the...
Sorry, I'm busy.
Yeah, no, you can really do that.
Right.
You kind of have to be deferential. But that's just the way it works.
Very good. And then, of course, you were there when they found out that the show was not going to be
Yeah, that was
continued, which was
a bombshell.
Yeah, I mean, what was that like? First of all, how did you find out, and what was the next day atmosphere on that set?
You know, it's funny. I think it's kind of telling, or it kind of speaks a bit to the importance of technology these days, because it actually ended up being one of the producer's assistants had read it on an entertainment blog.
Oh.
I think it's, Deadline Hollywood, Nikki Fink. And they were the first ones to break the story. And it was hilarious because here we are, you know, the actual crew of the show, and we had heard nothing about it, not from NBC, you know, not from anyone. And they were the first ones to kind of, you know, break the story. And from there, you know, people, you know, I guess you go through the stages of grief, and the first one was denial, and people mm-hmm. were like, oh, no, this can't possibly be true. You know, we have to, you know, wait until all the facts come out. But, you know, within days, it turned out to be absolutely true. And, yeah, it was really just that quick, you know. I think the thing that was kind of most tragic about it is that a lot of the people there, like I said, you know, they very much felt like a family.
Yeah.
And a lot of people had, you know, staked their entire careers on this. I mean, there were people who were on that show for 15 to even 20 years, the mm-hmm. whole run of it. And, you know, just to kind of have the rug swept out from under them like that, you know, so suddenly. I mean, it's always, you know, the thing is, it's always a risk mm-hmm. in that industry. You know, it's very volatile. But I think, you know, they'd become so comfortable in their position that they just, you know, they expected it to go on forever. And it wasn't like that.
What was the speculation, you know, in the group about why the decision was made?
Oh, I mean, I think, you know, I think a lot of things were floating around. I mean, I think definitely... You know, you kind of nobody really took personal blame. I don't think anybody on the crew, you know, said like, oh, maybe if I had, you know, painted this set a little bit more thoroughly, maybe they would have kept it going for another 5 years or anything like that. But, you know, it definitely they looked, you know, we looked to our kind of corporate overlords first, because mm-hmm. mm-hmm. I guess, you know, as kind of, you know, blue-collar workers, as you could call us on that scale, you know, that's who usually the blame rests with. And, you know, definitely that was it. NBC, Wolf Productions, who were, you know, which is Dick Wolf's company, mm-hmm. you know, we all kind of turned our attention to them. And And it was actually negotiations between the two of them, between Wolf and NBC, that ended up sealing the fate of it.
Well, I kind of think it's sort of like sports, where, you know, ultimately it's a business decision, as they always say.
And right, exactly, which is the unfortunate thing, because, you know, you as a common, you know, worker, it's very unfortunate, because you can you know, spend years doing your job very diligently and very well. But the, you know, question of whether or not you have a job at the end of the day really doesn't rest on your shoulders. It's on someone else's.
Yeah.
So that, you know, that kind of inspires in you to have to build a certain amount of, you know, individual fortitude and be able to stand on your own two feet and weather, you know, all kinds of different situations like that.
Well, we just have a couple minutes left, but there's one more project I'd like to talk about. This Kiss for Jed Wood.
Yeah.
Where you did some transport work, is that right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
tell us
about that. And that was another New York angle, right?
Yeah, well, it was funny because I was actually called on a number of times, and the indie world is very different than the larger scale world, in that, you know, people, it's a much smaller crew, and I think usually they call on people to kind of take on tasks that are, you know, would typically be considered above and beyond the call of duty, especially considering what your station is. So I, for example, was a production secretary, which is probably about a bump up from what I was doing on Law and Order.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, yeah, periodically I would have to drive actors to and from, you know, hotel rooms, to and from airports. I had to drive a big, you know, like a box cargo truck full of camera equipment, which never driven a truck before in my life. But, you know, through, you know, narrow streets of New York. But it's one of those things. It's just, you know, you kind of have to dive in head first and just do it and, you know, hope you don't take out somebody's mirror or something like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, God willing, you'll come out at the end of it and, you know, you'll have another notch in your belt, and you'll be able to say that there's one more thing you can do. And that's basically how I've, you know, proceeded through my career to this point. But you know, I can say I've taken off fewer mirrors than I've successfully driven trucks through the street. So hopefully I stay that way.
What a great final thought.
Yeah.
Well, I just want to thank you very much for being with us today and sharing your insight and your wisdom, and good luck with the rest of your
thank
career.
You very much. I appreciate it.
This has been Studio A. My name is Rick Davis. Thanks very much for watching.